All right, good morning, church. Good to see your faces. Glad you're here with us. Everyone online, welcome. We're glad you're here. Looks like this is our, we're here as a church family. I'm just like seeing your faces. I'm just so glad you're here. I find it a really big privilege to have this opportunity to share what God's put on my heart. And I just hope that you come in today. I don't know where you've been on, you know, during this week, but I hope you come in and you just feel loved. You feel the unity that we have in Christ and as a church. You just feel encouraged by that. If you have your Bibles, turn your Bibles to Romans chapter 12. We're gonna jump in there. Romans chapter 12. Man, I'm really excited about what God's put in my heart. My heart is to present God's word in a way that maybe can present some breakthrough. And also, let's have some fun and seek the presence of the Lord. So I'll pray and then we'll get into it. Sound good? All right. Father, we love you. Thank you so much for this opportunity to just fix our eyes on you, on your scriptures. We ask you to come, Holy Spirit. Open up our ears. Awaken our spirit to what you have to say today. I pray that you are glorified. More of you, less of me. We pray that we can learn something. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. All right, so we are actually in a teaching series entitled The Supernatural Power of a Transformed Mind. We're in teaching number 3, Supernatural Power of a Transformer. I just love that title. You guys like that title? There's like just something on that, just like some sauce on that. The Supernatural Power of a Transformed Mind. So we're utilizing this source from Bill Johnson, Pastor Bill Johnson, who wrote a book entitled with the same title, The Supernatural Power of a Transformed Mind. And so you guys with me? And so basically what's going on with this is Pastor Bill is like tackling this idea, this reality. What does it look like to have our lives transformed by the renewing of our mind? What does it look like to to see from God's perspective? What does it look like to have Christ-likeness going on in all of our cognition and in our heart? And it also talks about what does it look like to walk in love? What does it practically look like to embody this in our daily life? What does it look like to walk in power, in the miraculous? What does it look like to walk in the inheritance that Jesus bought with his very blood? These are some of the things that we're kind of exploring through this book and through this series. In Romans chapter 12, verse 2, it says, "Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will." I love that passage. You know, it's interesting. Paul doesn't use the word change. He doesn't use the word grow or even heal. He uses the word transformed. Transformed. This word transformed comes from the same Greek word as metamorphosis. So transformation and metamorphosis. I see Pastor Andrew like nodding in approval. He knows Greek. So it's like, yeah, so the same Greek word, so we get transformation and metamorphosis being rendered by the same Greek word that Paul is using here. So picture what Paul's doing. He's talking, it's even bigger than change. It's even bigger than healing. We're talking about transformation. It's this complete change of character, complete change of appearance, complete change of condition. It's this holistic change that literally happens from the inside out. This is what Paul is referring to. It's this biblical kingdom, heaven, reality of a creature being transformed into a new creation. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, it says, "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, if you're a Christian, the new creation has come. The old has gone. The new is here." Repeat after me. New creation. One more time. New creation. Awesome. And everyone online, type in new creation. Man, this idea of new creation is so compelling to me. I mean, we're talking about the first fruits of heaven. Like, this is what new creation is. We're being transformed into the first fruits of the new reality of heaven consummated with earth. It's incredible. It's incredible. And, I was thinking about this, and I was kind of like meditating through this, and I was reminded of the stark transition, the example in nature and in biology of a caterpillar being transformed into a butterfly. You guys know what I'm talking about? You guys are probably familiar with that. There's this incredible process that's happened. Basically, we have this creature, this caterpillar. It's named a caterpillar. And then through this metamorphosis, this transformation, it literally becomes like a new creation. It's this new and different creation. It's so different, so new that we basically had to give it a new name, this butterfly, right? And this happens on a cellular level, on like the deepest level. And so sometimes it's like, oh, I knew about that in elementary school. But I think this is really a beautiful thing because God's like offering us this illustration. He's creator. He created all things. He created this as a word picture, as a picture, as an illustration. Hey, this is what's possible when you're in Christ and you commit yourself. This kind of transformation is possible for you on a spiritual level. It's incredible. So I actually have a video here. It's a minute and a half. It's this metamorphosis of a caterpillar being transformed into a butterfly. Check it out. And I want you to watch it with the eyes of realizing God's like, here, I'm giving you an illustration of what's possible spiritually. Sound good? Check this out. Pretty cool. I think it's actually incredible. This caterpillar literally is transformed into a butterfly. But as cool as that video is and as cool as this illustration is, let's just point out the obvious. Bugs are kind of weird, right? Bugs are just weird. Like, why? God created bugs, and I'm just like, why do they have to be so odd-looking? Like, just bizarre, you know? Bugs. Pastor Tammy, I know she loves bugs. I wish I can, like, tease her a little bit about that. Yeah, bugs are funny. Like, what's with, like, I guess just the whole cocooning process now sped up like 60 times, but like it's just odd, right? It's just hanging there, and just this weird girthy thing, right? And then I guess it's the abdomen, right? Is that probably what it was? The abdomen, or maybe I should say abdomen, to be like equal to women. Anyone know what I'm talking about? If you know, you know. Politics nowadays. Oh my goodness. Anyway, yeah. So. You know, another crazy thing about this illustration, there's so much from this that I'm taking. It's like another example from this illustration is this caterpillar is just like inching along on a twig. Just like, I'm just going where I'm going, just like inching along, right? And then after this transformation process, it literally can fly. Like, it literally can fly. Like, imagine you're just like, okay, I'm walking, now I can fly. Like God is literally, like, it almost sounds fanciful, and it kind of is, but at the same time, this is what's possible on a spiritual level. I think, like, God wants to blow off the ceiling of, like, our expectations, what's possible in this life with Christ. So this is what's possible, the renewal, this kind of renewal through this transformation of our mind, living a whole new reality. It's incredible. This is what I want to explore with you guys today. This is what, in our few moments together, I want to kind of explore, like, what does it take to live in this kind of reality? Like, what does it take to live in this kind of transformation? Maybe another question is, what are we doing? Like, are we living a life that's conducive for this kind of transformation? I'm asking myself this question. Maybe a better question is, what are some hindrances? What are some ways that we stop this renewing process of our mind and this life of transformation, this life marked by renewal and even flight? In Romans chapter 8, verse 38, it says, "For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither the height nor depth, or anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus, our Lord." I love that passage. It's one of my favorite passages. I mean, it's talking about virtually the impossibility of God's love being separated from us. This is so securing, isn't it? Like, we're talking about eternal security in God's love. None of these things can stop the love of God. And it's good. It's a good thing, because it's the love of God that transforms us. It's the activity of God's love. It's like the manifestation, the working, and the good works that come from God's love that transforms us. These are good things. So, but, you know, Paul talks about this. He talks about all these. This list is kind of interesting. You know, he talks about death and life. He talks about demons and angels. He talks about the present and the future. He talks about powers, height or death, all creation. And I want to highlight this time sequence that Paul talks about, the present and the future. The present can't separate you from God's love. The future can't separate you from God's love. But he kind of leaves out the past. You know, it's kind of interesting. Like, I'm not really sure if, like, Paul intentionally left out the past from this list. But I do know that the past can be a huge hindrance for us, like, for us to step into a renewed mind. It can. The past so often, I mean, I speak from experience and just from my own experience, like, in life, the past so often holds us back, doesn't it? It just holds us back. So the question is, how do we get past our past? How do we get past our past and step into this life of transformation, this life of renewed mind? I want to tell you this story, this quick story. So, eighth grade, middle school, I'm in eighth grade, middle school, and the school dance is approaching. So picture, like, you know, eighth grade, middle school, and it's never awkward. You know, it's just totally smooth. I was never awkward. I was just very, very smooth, very cool all the time. Nope, not at all. I was as awkward as it gets. And, you know, there's a lot of stuff going on in middle school. There's a lot of growing, a lot of hormones, a lot of things happen, a lot of change. So eighth grade, the school dance is approaching, and I'm really excited about it. I'm just like, the school dance is coming. It's going to be so fun. My crush is going to be there. I'm going to dance, and I'm obviously going to be really impressive because I got all the moves. I thought that. And I'm excited for it. And then finally the day came. It was like me just like, it was almost like this graduated form of like looking forward to Christmas, but an eighth grade version. I'm like, all right, Friday's here. I remember like putting on some digs, like putting on my clothes, putting on my gel. And I had that old school gel back then where it was like gelatinous, see-through, like lime green. And you just like right on your hand, way too much. And it was just basically like concrete. But I thought I looked fly. I was ready to go. And then my mom and dad dropped me off at the school, at the cafeteria. We like start like petering in, all the students petering in. And there's just like this weird air of like nervousness and awkwardness. And we're kind of coming into the cafeteria, and there's like, you can hear some music, and I'm just kind of like nervous but excited. And I'm like, man, what's this dance gonna be like? And we get there, and it was like, automatically there was like this segregation that took place. It was like the boys on one side, and then the girls on that side. You guys know what I'm talking about? And the boys are like, I don't know what to do with myself. What do I do with my hands? And then the girls are like, is a boy going to come over here and talk to me? You know, like all this internal monologue. But eventually over time, it kind of warms up, you know, and like music's playing. And people just kind of get used to things, and the ice melts. Well, it's middle school, so the ice doesn't ever fully melt. But, you know, it kind of like warms up a little bit, and the atmosphere starts to change, and it's a little bit more of a dance atmosphere. And instead of like being like this banner of self-consciousness, it's like, okay, we're at a school dance, and let's try to have fun. And I remember like distinctly thinking to myself, like, I love this. I got so into it. Like, I started dancing, and I started sweating, and all my gels like sweating on my forehead. And it was just like really, like, I was just so into it. And it's kind of a little bit out of character, because I normally don't really let loose like that, but I remember just being like dancing like my heart out. And It was fun. And so we're all dancing, and we're finally, like, you know, the atmosphere is picking up, and this circle in the middle of the dance floor, like this opening, kind of like balloons out. You guys know what I'm talking about? When you're at a dance party, and like it just kind of circles out, and people start, like, getting in the middle and start dancing a little bit. And it's like pre-TikTok, but it's kind of just as weird as like the TikTok dances, middle school dances. So that's happening. And I'm like, I thought I was already pumped up, but when that happened, I was like really pumped. I was really pumped. I was like, I'm going to go in the middle of that dance floor, of that circle, and I'm going to dance. I was thinking to myself, and I was warming myself up. So pause the story right there. 2 weeks earlier, I had literally, like, pictured that happening. I had, like, 2 weeks earlier, I was, like, fantasizing about the school dance, and that this circle was going to happen, and that I was going to go in there, and it was going to be so awesome, and I was going to like dance and be so cool and be the most popular because I got all the dance moves. And, you know, eighth grade Zach, like, obviously knows, you know, so much wisdom. So in the meantime, in those 2 weeks, I'm like, I caught myself kind of just dancing. I'll brush my teeth, and I'm just like dancing a little bit, like just kind of practicing, you know, just like getting it. And I'm just like, oh, I can't wait for the dance. It's going to be awesome. And then it started to evolve a little bit, and I would catch myself downstairs in the basement and just kind of like swinging and like doing like weird, like what can my body do kind of thing. And then I heard about breakdancing. And so you guys know what breakdancing is? I'm sure you do. So there's this move called the windmill. There's the windmill. So basically the windmill, I'm not going to show you, but the windmill is like, you got it ready? Nah. Trust me, you'd want me, you just feel like, it'd be like this story all over again. That's what it would be. It'd be like a weird retelling of what happened. And then I would have to like talk about this story. Oh, man. So anyways, it's basically like you're popping off your stomach, like swirling on your back, kicking your legs and swirling your legs and stuff. And so basically, you look like a windmill. But when I did it, I look more like a car accident. Like I just kind of like look, I was just like falling down the stairs, like flopping around. And so I was like, whatever, no one's watching, I got this. And I kept practicing for 2 weeks. And so finally, nope, I never got it. But I thought to myself, you know what, at the dance, I'll probably get it, man, because I'll have adrenaline and like it'll be the day. And like, you know, obviously it's going to happen, like just very hopeful thinking. Eighth grade, like just note to self, now I know if it doesn't work in practice, it's not going to work in performance. A little spoiler alert. So anyway, back to the dance. So the circle is like swelling out and, you know, like the music is pumping and my heart is pumping and I'm looking for my moment. And finally, like the circle is empty. I'm like, this is it. I'm going. And so I jump in the circle. I start dancing. And then I'm like, whoa, what am I doing? I'm dancing and everyone's looking at me and this is really awkward. This is really, oh my goodness, what do I do? And everyone's like looking at me. And I remember thinking to myself like, okay, well, this is the perfect time to do the windmill. So I whip out the windmill and I just swing my leg around. And it was just like before. I looked like I was falling down a staircase in like one spot. And it was so bad, guys. Like, you're probably getting the picture. It was so bad, but like, it was like embarrassing, I think, because I kept falling basically and flopping. It was like one of those times when you're embarrassed for the person. It's like, you're so embarrassing that I'm embarrassed for, it's like secondhand embarrassment. You know what I'm talking about? It was one of those situations. And I kept going. It was just like a weird loop. And like, finally one of my friends grabbed my leg and he pulled me out. He's like, you're done. And that's what happened. People started clapping. I was like, they're clapping because my buddy pulled me out of the circle. And so, man, needless to say, it was very, very embarrassing. And like for months afterwards, like people were just like, you know, giving me a hard time. My friends were kind of giving me like a playful hard time. But in the school, I was kind of known as like a dork for like that rest of the year. And I was like, thank goodness high school is next grade and I can just like start over. But it was just like the guy who tried too hard, the guy who ruined the dance. I didn't rule the dance, but it was like pretty like, oh my goodness, like what did he do? Like why did he do that to himself? And so I kind of got labeled, you know, I was like labeled like as like the guy who thought he was cool or, you know, just like the dork or whatever. And along with like that funny story, but other things that happened in my life, I kind of like realized that there was like this confluence or like this combo of like lies that were seated in my head. And it was just like, these things that, like, from my past, like, the things that I had gone through, things that caused me shame, were, like, these lies. It was just like, yeah, you're not really good enough. Like, you're just not very valuable. Like, people don't really like you. Like, you're kind of a waste of time. Like, you're not going to be really lovable unless you're impressive. You know, like, all these lies that were just kind of infiltrating my identity and my thought process and my mind. And it was like, you know, it came to be like this existential level kind of thing. And I don't know if like, if you can relate to that dance story. Maybe you do, and I'd love to hear about it. But I'm sure you can relate to just something in your past, maybe multiple things in your past, where you're just like, man, like, oh, that's just like the source, like the origin for so much shame or like embarrassment or just things that are just like, man, it's that stuff from my past is even to this day directly connected to my thought process and directly affected to like the way that I view the world, the way that I, like my worldview or my self-esteem or my ability, you know, the way I view other people or the way I view God or myself, you know, the way that I give and receive love, all that stuff is affected by our past. And these things are like, they're like a weed that, or weed, multiple weeds, weed eye, weeds, that are planted in your mind. And then they kind of like suck all of the nutrients from everything around it. And like, it sucks all the life from all the other things in your mind. Like these thoughts just plague us, don't they, sometimes. And some of these things like from our past are kind of funny, like these embarrassing stories. And we're just like, oh my goodness, I can't believe I did that or whatever. But to be honest, if we're real, sometimes there's things from our past where it's like, it's extremely, extremely serious. You know, like we're talking about abuse. We're talking about trauma. We're talking about loss, like loss of marriage, loss of family members, loss of dreams, whatever it may be. And then we also talk about sin, things that we've done. You know, the malevolence and just like, oh my goodness, I can't believe I even did that. You know, and it causes shame. It causes shame. And it's like, I watched this, my wife Rachel, she reposted this TikTok of this lady in her 30s, and it was like, the caption was like, every time I remember this like negative thing from my past or the negative thing from my 20s, and she's like watering a plant, and she's like, oh, she's like, oh, like she just remembered something. It's like, just kind of came in her mind. She's like, open up the fridge, and then just like memory, just like, ugh, like these things from my past like just kind of come back, and it's just like, yikes, right? And so often we, you know, we don't even know that it's, we think this way. Like, I think we've become so familiar with these things, and it's just part of, like, our thought process. And this is what I think Bill Johnson and what Paul is talking about, what God endeavors to, like, reveal. Like, it's so familiar. And so sometimes because the familiarity, we don't even realize that that's the source for negative behavior. And I speak from my own life, you know, just some of these things, we numb ourselves. We numb ourselves. We so often, I mean, whether it's maybe overeating, maybe it's porn, maybe it's alcohol, maybe it's work and success, maybe it's self-righteousness, and we just think to ourselves like, oh, I'm better than them, and like we judge other people, or maybe it's gossip, or social media, or video games, or movies, or shows, or whatever it may be, and then we give away all of our emotional investment to these things, and then we wonder why we don't have anything left for our spouse, or our kids, or our workplace, or that strange, you know, that, or that person at the grocery store who is in desperate need to know about Jesus. Yeah. The beautiful thing, though, the beautiful thing is that this is the reason why we even come here. The reason why we proclaim the name of Jesus is the gospel is a gospel of freedom. So, like, whatever we've been through, whatever hurt we've been through, whatever has happened to us, whatever we've done, the sin in our life, the bad behavior, the numbing, the coping, the secrets, the addictions, there is freedom. Amen? There is freedom for that. Man, I'm so grateful there is freedom for it. There is renewal for all of it. This is what is possible with God. An example that I really love from the Bible is the story and character of Peter. So Peter is the, you guys know him well, I'm sure, but like, for a little bit of context, he's one of the followers of Jesus, one of the 12. He becomes an apostle, becomes a leader of the church originally. And I love his example because his name was originally Simon. And he wasn't really known to be, like, reliable or be, like, steadfast or really honest even sometimes. Like, he wasn't known to be all those things. But Jesus, as we well know, renamed Simon what? Peter. Which means what? Rock. Which basically represents everything that Peter wasn't. But it did represent everything that Jesus knew Peter, who Peter really was, and who Peter was going to be. And I just love this because that's what God does. He like renames us, like he renames us in a redemptive way. He takes our weaknesses and he transforms them, and then it becomes our strength. And then it becomes a testimony of God's love and power. I love that God does that in our lives. So no matter where we've been, no matter what we've done, no matter what's happened to us, no matter what we're struggling with, God intends to transform you. and God is transforming you. He wants us to change our thinking. He wants us to renew our mind. It's a mindset thing. It's a mindset thing. It's an inside joke for my wife. I love you, babe. It's a mindset thing. Yeah. So no matter what you've been, no matter where you've been or what you've done, there's transformation. There's transformation. Maybe you're like, let me just throw it an example. Maybe you're like, man, I'm just living paycheck to paycheck. I'm struggling financially. I'm in debt. Like, I'm just like, I don't know how to even like get through this life right now. I feel like God's like, no, there, like, I'm going to pour so much like favor and like transformation on you that you are literally going to be like a wise financial advisor, and you're going to teach others how to break through out of like this kind of like debt and things like that. I'm going to just put so much on you. You're going to like be a fanatic for Dave Ramsey. You're going to get a tattoo on your shoulder. It's going to be awesome. Maybe not that far. But God does want to transform you. And another example is like you're struggling as a mom. Like you're just like, man, I just feel like I'm a kind of like a bad mom. Like I'm impatient. Like I just don't really know how to do this. I just don't know if I'm overwhelmed, right? I'm overwhelmed. I feel like God's like, no, you're actually called to be a mother. You're ordained to be a mother. Like you're actually a spiritual mother. And like you're going to be like so transformed, you're going to teach others how to be a good mother. This is God's intention for us as those in Christ. Out of our greatest weakness, God can raise up our greatest strength. Truly, truly. I think of people even in our own family of church here. Like people who have seen so much like brokenness and sin and like, I think of Britton and Stephanie. I asked their permission if I could share this. Just like their marriage was on the brink of destruction. Britton was dealing with like sexual addiction and brokenness for like maybe a really long time. Like things were just not where they were supposed to be. They're just ugly times. And now like it's actually their testimony. I'm like getting emotional. It's actually their testimony. It's like that's what God does. He takes our weakness and our brokenness and our things from our past and he transforms them by the cross. And he allows them to be the ministry in which we actually are like motivated to live. It's a walking epistle. It's a walking testimony of the love and power of God. It's incredible. God has supernatural transformation for you. For you. But I think the thing is, he's inviting us to get past our past. He's inviting us to get past our past. In Philippians chapter 3, verse 13, it says, forgetting the past and looking forward to what lies ahead, I press on to reach the end of the race and receive the heavenly prize for which God, through Christ Jesus, is calling us. Let's get our mind, let's get our mind out of the past and onto the purposes of God. Let's allow him to change our thinking. God desires and empowers us to change the blunders of our past into present and future beauty. Like the book of Isaiah, one of my favorite verses in the whole Bible, in 61, chapter 61, verse 3, it says, he wants to give us a crown of beauty for ashes. Give me your ashes. Give me the ashes of your past, and I'll crown you with beauty. This is what God does. And if we are a follower of Jesus, we need to remember that we are free and forgiven. We are free and forgiven. The reality of the gospel is that Jesus came. Jesus, the Son of God, came and lived a sinless life. And then he bought all of our past, all of our problems, all of our hurts, all of the shame, all the things with our family. He bought them with his atoning blood. And he allowed himself to be laid on the cross with all those things. And so essentially all of our past, the beauty in this, all of our past belongs to God. And he dealt with it on the cross. So all of our past, all of the problems, all the negativity actually doesn't belong to us anymore. Like I need to remind myself of that. And I think you might even need to like go from here and remind yourself of that. Your past, it doesn't belong to you. You don't own the past problems of your past. Jesus bought it. And so Bill Johnson in his book, he highlights this in a kingdom way, in a heaven kingdom way. Like it's actually illegal to try to live in the bad fruit of our past. It's actually illegal for us to try to own the things, the bad things that either we did or happened to us. Glory to God. Hallelujah. It's like an incredible reality. It's an incredible reality. This is what's possible. We can live a transformed life. We can live a life fully alive in Christ, a life marked by forgiveness and redemption and destiny and wholeness and purpose and power. It's incredible. This is the invitation for all of us who are in Christ. So let's allow God to renew our mind, transform our life. Amen. Right now, would you do me a favor? Would you close your eyes? I just want to do just a couple moments of ministry time. I feel like God, he's so here. So we just give you our attention, Lord. And if even while I was preaching church, if there was anything that was like conjured up in your memory or something that you've dealt with in your past, something that's plaguing you, and if you want freedom right now, I want to give us an opportunity to just be released from it. Because of what Jesus has done, there's nothing we do by our own work. It's just the work of the cross and what Jesus has done in the Holy Spirit. So if there's something from our past, you want to just freedom from it right now, would you be bold and raise your hand right now? I want freedom of this. I see hands. Amen. Amen. Yeah, there's so much freedom for us. So I just pray right now for those who rose their hand and maybe those who didn't. I'm sure more people could raise their hand. We just break off these things from the past. We unhitch our life from these things that are plaguing us, and we yoke ourselves to you, Jesus Christ. Thank you that there's so much power in your name. You're so precious. So we just elevate you, God, not by our own efforts, but what you have done. We thank you in faith for forgiveness, for breakthrough, and for freedom. Thank you that you're transforming us. I thank you that for some of us, this is a pivot into flight spiritually. Oh, we're so grateful for you. Yeah, with eyes closed, if there's anyone in this place or anyone online who just says, I need more of Jesus. I need to be restored, or I don't even know him and I want a relationship with him. I want eternal life. I want purpose. Would you be bold and would you raise your hand? I see your hand. I see your hands. Amen. God, so proud of you. Lord, we pray for these people who raise their hands who want restoration, they want salvation, they want eternal life, they want purpose. We just pray that. We thank you for it. Yeah, we thank you for it. This is the beginning of some beautiful things, some transformation. Yeah. We give you all the glory, Jesus. We adore you. We worship you. We worship you. We say, come. We're ready for you. But in the meantime, as we wait faithfully and with transformation. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 That's awesome, guys. Well, thank you so much for joining us today. I hope that blesses you. Feel free, especially if you put up your hand and you want prayer, we'll have a prayer team, I believe, up here. And then we'll get rocking. I hope you have a great week. If you need anything, reach out. We love you. Until then, see you guys.